On Friday, a lance pierced his side, And today in his compassion the waters of baptism flow. On Friday he was crowned with thorns, and today he has adorned his church with a crown of splendor. Today is the day of rejoicing in the resurrection. Today is the day of rejoicing for all who have gone to their rest in the hope of the resurrection. Today is with this fragrance of this incense, the church and her children celebrate and sing hymns of glory, saying, O Creator of life, you have saved us by your passion and have given us life by your resurrection. Now renew our image by your grace. Clothe our bodies with the power of the Spirit, so that we may shine in the robe of glory and in its light to see you, the true bridegroom. In your grace make us and all the faithful departed worthy of your heavenly kingdom, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Thank you.
people, conquered death to give new life.
Lord, our God, you accepted what the just had offered you. Now accepting your mercy, our new sacrifice and praise.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians.
Glory to the Lord Paul, the apostles, may the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, and your children forever.
Brothers and sisters, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you once lived, following the age of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the desires of our flesh, following the wishes of the flesh and the impulses that were by nature children of wrath, like the rest. But God, who is rich in mercy, and because of the great love he has had for us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, brought us to life with Christ. By grace you have been saved, raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavens of Christ Jesus, that in ages to come he might show immeasurable riches of his grace in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from you. It is a gift of God. It is not from works, so no one may boast, for we are his handiwork, created in Christ Jesus for the good works that God has prepared in advance, that we should live in them. Praise be to God always.
Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you used to dress yourself and go where you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch forth your hands, and someone else shall dress you and lead you where you do not wish to go. He said this, signifying by what kind of death he would glorify God. When he had said this, he said to him, follow me. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God. For giving us his words of life. Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord and God.
And when he had said this, he says to him, follow me. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. One of these Wednesday evenings with the adult religion class, we'll probably go through this gospel. It's very detailed. We have two different ways in the original text. In English, it all looks the same. But in fact, in the text of the gospel itself, we have two different verbs for the word for love. We have two different words for knowledge, you know all things, but two ways of saying knowing. And also the way that we've translated feeding and tending sheep. We have two different terms here. And of course, because that is the inspired text, they have meanings. But it's not the thing that we're going to look at today. We begin with this last line of the gospel today. And when our Lord had said all of these things to Peter, St. John writes, he says to him, follow me. You come after and you follow after me. What our Lord is doing here, we considered last week already, centers around this charcoal fire. As we mentioned, it's the only places in this, many places in the New Testament, and in this gospel of this charcoal brazier. So this fire around which our Lord, in this case, has made breakfast. But of course, reflecting the earlier time, a month before, of St. Peter around the fire in the courtyard of the high priest's house. And these are both details that St. John, who is personally present at these episodes, desires us to know. They echo one another. And of course, the charcoal fire that's at the high priest's courtyard that we know of was Simon denying our Lord three times, cussing and swearing at the questioning of some young girl, some servant girl who was there. And there's a fascinating detail that I'll give you with, it seems to be that we can see from the text. One of the things that she keeps pounding on him when she comes back to him saying that night is, you speak like a Galilean. You have a twang. We can tell. We know how you talk. You sound like you're from Mississippi. We know that you must be with him. So there's something about St. Peter's dialect, accent, from the north. And we know from other historical documents that, in fact, there have always been a distinction of the north and the south ways of speaking the Hebrew and Aramaic. But what's fascinating is St. John doesn't get pulled into that. St. John, who's recording all of this, doesn't speak about anything about him being asked any questions. So there are two things that the other second detail of is that the reason why John and Simon are even in that courtyard is because St. John tells us in the gospel that the other disciple, meaning himself, was known to the family of the high priest. So they just let him in because they know him. And Simon kind of comes running in behind him. Now this is a fascinating detail because the question becomes, are James and John, James's feast who's tomorrow, the brother of John, and the family of Zebedee, is Zebedee originally from Judea, from the south? And did they then later on move to the north to begin fishing on Lake Genezareth? It's an interesting detail. He's known to the high priest, the family knows him, there's a family relation, and knowledge at least. And so they let him in. And the servants who are there don't recognize any distinction to inquire about John as being a disciple. It's just, I just mentioned to you in passing, but it's a fascinating little detail that's in the gospel. And of course, Peter just collapses. He's being put on the spot. This is a night that says he's not been sleeping all night. They've been up celebrating the Passover. This is already going well into its 20th hour of him being awake and moving around and being alive, just simply being awake. And having this woman, this young woman, pestering him about this question. And we're told he cusses and he swears and he tells you he doesn't know. But our Lord had told him the night before, or earlier in that same night. Because Simon, when our Lord announces the Last Supper, one of you is going to betray me tonight. Simon is the first one to pipe up. Well, even if everyone else betrays you, not me. I will follow you even to death. There is a presumption there, and that puffed self-centeredness which always leads us into problems. And that problem we know, of course, will be the denials that night. The other detail about this episode is, remember that the name Kepha, that in the Greek becomes Petros, boulder, rock. That this name is given by our Lord himself to Simon when he first meets him. Andrew brings his brother Simon, his older brother probably, brings him in to meet who he's calling the Messiah. And our Lord, when he sees Simon, says, well, from now on, we're going to call you rock. We're going to call you boulder. And Simon, of course, would be bewildered by this. This is not a name that anyone uses. I mean, we have Peters all over the place now. But at the time, nobody had this name. And this is an important point because of what's going to happen at this end of the gospel. And so when St. John lays this whole thing out, he begins by saying, when they had finished eating, our Lord says to Simon Peter, John uses his full name with the nickname that our Lord had given him, not just Simon. And we have to remember that what precedes this moment, remember the detail we talked about last week, that as they're coming in and they've dragged in these 153 fish, John is the one who says, oh, even shouts it out, this is the Lord. Simon just goes barreling over the side of the boat and swims the rest of the way, completely impetuous. But what's interesting in the detail there is that we're not told that Peter recognizes him, but he accepts John's recognition. This is different from a month before, when even if everyone else is a loser and betrays you, not me, here he's relying on John saying, this is the Lord. And Simon just barrels over the side. So when they finished eating, John gives us in the gospel the inspired text. Our Lord then says to Simon Peter, what our Lord is now going to do, and what we can admire here, is the great gentleness of our Lord to allow Simon to make reparation for this completely disastrous night a month before. And so that's part of the reason why he's asked three times about love. You denied me three times. Do you love me? But again, it's in different forms, this word. But at the same time, our Lord is not going to let him get away. This is like when the blind beggar is brought to our Lord and we consider it during Lent. Our Lord knows he's begging and he's blind, but he asks the blind man, what do you wish from me? What do you want me to do for you? The blind man has to say, in a sense, to acknowledge, Lord, that I may see. Acknowledge what is wounded in me. Acknowledge what is broken in me. And he makes him say, he doesn't just simply heal him. And here is the same thing. Our Lord can completely just forgive Simon. But there are two things happening here. One, as we mentioned, is the reparation. And the second thing is a lesson for all of us. Since the 1960s, we've really been into who we are. How do I express myself? What can I do? How do I exuberantly, how do I find myself, express myself, etc.? And that's fine, beginning with tie-dyed shirts, it's okay. But it's deficient. It's insufficient. What we rarely ask ourselves is the other part of the question is what am I? And what does God intend me to be in my life? Those are two different things. Finding myself, discovering myself, expressing myself, okay. That's part of the question of life. But the other question is what does God desire me to be? I've certainly told some of you that when I was in high school, I was going to the University of Michigan. I was studying surgery. I'd always been planning on this. I was always going to be a physician since I was a little squirt. And in my senior year, there was a sermon given on the second Sunday in the Latin calendar, which is Good Shepherd Sunday. And the sermon was on vocations, which is what we just simply did every single year on that Sunday, was we preached on vocations. Okay, fine. Now, I'm a senior. I'm 2 months before graduating. I have everything lined up with the University of Michigan. I even have a roommate assigned to me. All we're waiting is for the placement exams and get everything in place. Plus, I have this lovely, lovely brunette sitting next to me. And this sermon on vocations comes up, and I don't remember the sermon, typical of all Catholics sitting in pews. I don't know what he said on Sunday. But he finished the sermon with a rhetorical question. And he said, therefore, every young man who's in this church today has to ask himself what God desires of him, whether he wishes him to be a priest. Now, this was my moment of Damascus, being like waylaid off of my pew, dressed straight off the pages of GQ, with a beautiful brunette, everything all set up, scholarship set up for U of M. All of the puffedness of the world and its vanity was mine. But that last question was not, therefore every young man needs to think about becoming a priest. Because every 18, every 17-year-old would just go, I don't know, I'm a priest. But he didn't ask that question. He said, therefore, you must ask the question whether God desires you to be a priest. That's the what in our lives. And of course, totally derailed my entire existence. To the point where I'm not doing surgery. I mean, I may be dissecting your brain Sunday after Sunday and causing you pain and vivisection through this attempt. But it's because I did ask that question. What? Not who. I knew in my arrogant adolescent mind who I was. That was fine. My puffed up vanity, I knew who. But that question came along and popped the who and said, you have to ask what? And that's what's happening in this episode today. Which is why John introduces it to the point where our Lord is asking Simon Peter, John tells us. But the question which is asked of this man is, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than all of these? After all, a month ago you said, even if everyone else is a total loser and betrays you, I'm not going to. So our Lord asks the question, but as I mentioned to you, and I have to mention this detail, and I have in past sermons too, the verb that our Lord uses of love, it's not translatable in English because we only have one word for love, but this notion of love is this adherence and a selfless devotion to another. Do you love me in this way more than the rest of them? And you notice that what Simon does at that moment is he doesn't address the second part of the question. He doesn't say anything about anybody else. But he says to our Lord, you know that I love you as a friend, as He doesn't presume to this self-sacrificing verb. They use two different verbs. It's translated as love, but it's two different verbs in the text. Very clear. And our Lord says, feed my lambs. What? What is Simon, son of John, supposed to be doing? You feed the lambs. You instruct, teach, guide. And then our Lord asks the question again. He drops off this time more than these. And says, okay, we'll wiggle it down here a little bit. Simon, son of John, do you love me in this selfless, devotional attachment of love? And Simon answers again, Lord, you know. You know that I love you as a companion. Doesn't presume. Tend my sheep. Lead them. Guide them. And that's why we now come to this mysterious part in English, when the question is repeated. Simon, son of John, do you love me? And then we have this parenthetic aspect where we're told by St. John is that Simon's upset. When we read it in English, it looks like he's upset because he's just asked for a third time. It's like, I already answered twice, what's the problem here? But that's not what's happening here. That's what it looks like in English. But the third time around, our Lord says, Simon, son of John, do you love me as a companion? And he's upset because our Lord has lowered the standard, and he's never answered to the higher standard because he's not going to presume to it. But when someone that we love goes, all right, can you just do this for me then? Love is being shattered at that point. If your marriage degenerated into a form where it's good to keep each other around because he or she's a paycheck and the other one takes care of the house, that's just a partnership. That's not a marriage. That's okay, it works, so we keep it together. So nobody considers that to be love if we just simply worked out efficiency. I mean, we certainly know a lot of people who live this way. But we wouldn't call it matrimonial love in the sense of self-sacrificing. And when that does happen within a marriage, we realize something's off the track. And that's the same thing here. So Peter doesn't presume to this selfless love. But when our Lord lowers the standard down to, do you love me as a companion? Even though Simon answers exactly the same way. Lord, you love, you know all things, you know everything. Notice he adds it at the end. You know everything, and you know that I love you as a companion. He answers with the same verb in the third time. But he's sad because our Lord lowered the standard. But in becomes the what again? To feed my sheep. So there's this beautiful aspect of the who and the what that all of us have to ask ourselves, not every single day of our life, but certainly on a regular basis. That's the aspect that we pray with our hands open. We wait for the answers of God to show us not only who we are, but also what He desires us to be. Not what I feel like becoming or doing, but what God wants me to be and what He wants me to be. That's a totally different question, which is why then our Lord immediately says, under oath, amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself, you girded yourself up, and you went wherever you wished. But I'm telling you that in the future, there's going to come a point when somebody else is going to gird you up, tie you, and lead you to where you do not wish to go. Now clearly our Lord is playing on some kind of a saying that was common in the day, because John has to explain it to us in another parenthesis. That our Lord is talking about the way that he would die in glorifying God. So all of this is brought together with the question of the who and the what, and then with the quotation that we began with today. And after our Lord had said all these things, a loud reparation, mercifully, kindly, but seriously to make reparation, he also pointed out what Simon, son of John, was meant to be And St. John says that after he had said all of these things, he says to him, now follow me. The who and the what are essential. That's what we finish with today's grace that we're looking for. Is that God give us the knowledge about who we are. But that probably more important, what escapes our vision, is what we are meant to be in God's desire. What our lives are supposed to be. Then when these two things come together in our prayer, who we are and what we are, then we are ready to listen to that third voice of our Lord when he says, now come, take up your cross daily and follow me. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Thank you.
your holy name, shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your kingdom. We recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God and men unto this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Catherine of Siena. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Abundance
abundance of your grace, accept our prayers. Make us children and heirs of your kingdom through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, and through your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Humanity exalts you, and all creation glorifies you. Look upon your children and call out to you. With purity and holiness may we offer you an acceptable sacrifice, that we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Sabishta menei
dia tiki chadato. Dachlofai ko vachlofsagie mete shedul metina. Chosoya chave vachoye na ala alni.
Church, which you have redeemed.
Gather her children into unity, love, and faith, and guide them in peace and in security. We offer it for the pure bishops of the true faith, Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Nisrala Peter, our retired Patriarch, Gregory John, our Bishop, the venerable priests, the chaste deacons, the pure subdeacons, and all the orders of the Church. Teach them the word of truth so that they may spread it faithfully, with justice and holiness. May they care for the flock that you have entrusted to them. Give them the proper means to accomplish your will, and grant them a long life. We pray to you,
Lord. Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and dejected, for orphans and widows, for the sick and distressed, for those tempted by evil spirits, be the guardian and refuge of their lives. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, your holy church that you established on a solid rock of true faith, and send her vocations to the holy priesthood and religious life. In a world of distractions, which pull us away from properly loving you and our neighbor, may those whom you have called to serve your holy church respond to you and have the courage to follow your will. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember the holy fathers, prophets, apostles, preachers, evangelists, martyrs, and confessors, especially the holy, glorious, and blessed ever Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. John the Baptist, the messenger and forerunner who witnessed the betrothal of your holy church to your son, glorious St. Stephen, the archdeacon and first martyr, and all who pleased you and professed your name, we pray to you, O Lord.
Altar from every place throughout the world, grant them rest in your heavenly dwellings with all your sins, and in your mercy forgive our sins and theirs.
Grant us, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed with
our
lawful knowledge.
O Lord, do not deprive us of your mercy, but keep us in the palm of your hand, lest we fall and go astray, so that we may walk on your path, follow your ways and do your will. Forgive us and our departed, and pardon all sins and transgressions hidden and seen, committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will, that in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Lord, our Lord, you sent us your only Son, who is the radiance of your eternity, and he accomplished his plan of salvation for us, that we may come to you. May we call upon you with the prayer that he taught his holy disciples, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Yes, O merciful Lord, we ask for your compassion. By your grace, make us worthy that your glorious name may be made holy in us. That your kingdom come to assist us in our weakness, and that your will dwell within us. Deliver us from all difficult temptations. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord God, you are good and the lover of all people. Look upon those who bow their heads before your majesty, and bless them with every spiritual blessing. Do not turn us away when we approach your divine and holy gifts, and let us not be guilty of unworthily receiving the body and blood of your only Son. Rather, make us worthy to share in your holy and life-giving mysteries with purity, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your good and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for the life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Yeah.
Lord Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these your gifts and graces and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies, and your blood with our souls for the pardon of faults, the forgiveness of sins, and eternal life. You are blessed, and your kingdom is holy, and we raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
O God the Father, we bow before you, and we entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your mercy, to rest your right hand full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by your holy cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
So I wish to take this moment to thank all of the volunteers who came in this weekend to prepare for this evening's supper. And hopefully we'll see you all back this evening for the supper. So the ladies told me that they hadn't seen as many people show up for the working in the kitchen, which was absolutely wonderful. And the men who also showed up, it's not just the ladies. So as you know, for the last decade or so, we, the church, our beloved church, always runs at quite a large deficit. So these fundraisers that we bring in to punctuate the year, this time, Christmas Bazaar, they are absolutely essential to the survival of St. Joseph's. Not just simply ornamentation of St. Joseph, but for her survival. And so thank you from the bottom of the heart for your devotion to this community and for the beautiful generosity which you've shown this weekend, though I know the big cleanup's tonight, so there's still work to be done, but I look forward to seeing you all this evening, and thank you again. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.